Hello everyone. In this lecture, we'll be defining convergence of sequence of random variables. First of all, how sequence of random variables is different from sequence of real numbers. We have already seen this once, but let me revise. So when you say something is a random variable, omega comes into picture, right? X of omega is a function from omega to r. When I go for a sequence of random variables, I have x1 omega, x2 omega, and so on. So it is denoted by xn omega. So now two things come into picture, n and omega. Because it is a sequence, n has to vary, and because it's a random variable, omega has to vary. Okay. As a result, it can actually be written as x1. Let me, for the sake of convenience, let me assume that omega is countable. So I will have omega 1, omega 2, etc. But this can of course be generalized to uncountable case also. So I can write this as x1 omega 1, x2 omega 1, x3 omega 1. So across row I am keeping omega constant. And this I would write as x2 omega 1, sorry. And the second row I would write as x1 omega 2, x2 omega 2, x3 omega 2, and so on. So basically, across column I'm keeping n constant, whether it is x1 or x2 or etc. And across rows I'm keeping omega constant. So when I say I'm keeping omega constant, x1 of omega 1 is a real number. Similarly, x2 of omega 1 is another real number. Okay, so every row actually becomes a sequence of real numbers. Okay, so second row is second sequence of real numbers. Third row is third sequence of real numbers. And hence, each of them may converge or may not converge. Okay. So, if at all each of them converge, so suppose this converges to some number, let me call that number as x of omega 1. The second thing converges to some other number, let me name that as x of omega 2, and so on. So, if it converges for every omega, then we have what is known as pointwise convergence. Okay. However, it may not converge always. It may happen that for some omegas, means for some rows it converges, for other rows it doesn't converge. Okay. Hence, we need to have different notions of convergence of sequence of random variables. Why? Because sequence of random variables is equivalent to collection of many sequences of real numbers. Okay. This is equivalent to collection of many sequences of real numbers. How many? Actually, the number of sequences would be same as number of elements in omega. So if capital omega is uncountable, I will have collection of uncountably many sequences of real numbers. If capital omega is finite, I would have collection of finitely many sequences of real numbers. Okay. Hence, we can't have a single definition of convergence of a sequence just like we used to have in real analysis. We need to have multiple notions. So let me start with the simplest one, that is pointwise convergence. Okay. So in this above picture, if for every row I have a convergence, means if for every omega I get some limit as a real number, then I will call the first limit as x of omega 1, second as x of omega 2, and so on. Okay, so this x which takes these values would be called as the pointwise limit of my sequence. Okay, so we say that a sequence of random variables xn converges pointwise to a random variable x if and only if for every row I have to have a sequence convergence like real number, right? So if and only if given epsilon greater than 0, there exists n naught, which depends on epsilon of course, and now for every row I can have different n naught because every row is a different sequence of real numbers. Okay, so it can depend on epsilon such that mod of xn omega minus x omega is less than epsilon for every n greater than or equal to that particular n naught, and this should happen for every omega in omega. Okay, so you fix omega. For that omega given a particular epsilon, I get some n naught beyond which I have convergence like in the usual real sequence sense. Okay, this is your convergence of real sequence definition. Okay, and for the same epsilon, for if you change omega, you will get different n naught, correct? And if this happens for every omega, means for every omega you can find n naught beyond which this thing happens, means xn is within epsilon limits of x, then we say that the convergence is pointwise. Okay, so let me so suppose my omega consists of minus 1 and plus 1. Okay, so omega has only two possible values, suppose minus 1 and plus 1. And let me define xn omega as omega plus 1 by n. Okay, xn omega is defined as omega plus 1 by n. Now, as I said, I will have two sequences, one for each omega. So, when omega is equal to minus 1, our entries would be minus 1 plus 1 by 1, minus 1 plus half, minus 1 plus 1 by 3, and so on. Okay, so this is one sequence of real numbers. When omega is equal to plus 1, I will have 1 plus 1 by 1, 1 plus half, 1 plus 1 by 3, and so on. Okay, as you can see easily from sequence of real numbers, this converges to minus 1 because the 1 by n term goes to 0. This converges to plus 1. So my limit is x of omega is omega. Why? Because when omega is minus 1, x of omega is minus 1. When omega is plus 1, x of omega is plus 1. Okay. So x of omega is omega. So this converges to x of omega, which is equal to omega. And we would say it converges pointwise because it converges for every possible value of omega. Okay. Is it okay? Can you see how this converges pointwise? If instead, if I simply define x of omega is equal to 1. Okay. So if I define x of omega is equal to omega, it's fine. Now I have another random variable y of omega, which takes value 1 for both omegas. Okay. Then my xn omega does not converge to y omega pointwise. Why? Because for omega equal to 1, it works. But for omega equal to minus 1, the limit is minus 1, whereas value of y is plus 1. So they don't match. Hence, xn omega converges to this x omega, where x omega is omega, but xn omega does not converge to y omega pointwise, where y omega is 1. Okay, so this is the definition of pointwise convergence. It has to happen for every omega. Now, some people felt that, you know, demanding the convergence for every omega is a very strong requirement. So can we simplify it a bit? Hence came the concept of almost sure convergence. Okay. So what we are going to say here in almost sure convergence, convergence does not have to happen for every omega. Okay. So there may be some omegas for which convergence doesn't happen. For example, here we saw that if omega is equal to minus 1, convergence doesn't happen. However, we put a condition that probability of all such omegas for which convergence doesn't happen should be 0. Okay, means if I have my omega, okay, and let me divide omega in two parts. So this is the part where convergence happens. So for all these omegas, the convergence happens, whereas this is small part where convergence doesn't happen. If probability of this small part is 0, then we will say that we have almost sure convergence. Okay, we'll say we don't have pointwise convergence, but we'll have almost sure convergence. So let me write down the definition. Again, xn be a sequence of random variables. Suppose there exists a set n such that probability of n is equal to 0, n is of course subset of omega, and xn omega converges to x omega for every omega in n complement. So outside capital N, xn omega converges to x omega for every omega. Okay, then we say that xn converges to x almost surely. Okay, because probability of n complement is going to be 1, it is also said that xn converges to x with probability 1. Okay, that is another way of saying it. Okay, what do I mean by this? So let me take another example. So suppose omega is closed interval 0, 1. Okay, so I have now uncountably infinitely many omegas, small omegas. And let me define xn of omega as e raised to omega plus omega raised to n. Okay, xn of omega is defined as e raised to omega plus omega raised to n, and probability measure on this omega is same as Lebesgue measure. So probability of any interval of the type AB would be defined as B minus A, where of course A and B are in 0, 1 and A less than B. And if I define probabilities of intervals, then all other probabilities can be defined, because we have already shown that intervals, minimal sigma field generated by intervals is the Borel sigma field, right? So if I know probability of intervals by intersection, I can get probability of the singletons, doubletons, etc. In fact, probability of open interval is this, and we define probability of closed interval also in the same way, B minus A. And this tells me that probability of singleton A or probability of singleton B is 0. So basically probability of every singleton is 0. Okay. Now xn omega is defined as this, and let me define x of omega as just e raised to omega. Okay. X of omega is defined as just e raised to omega. Now does this xn converge to x? Now this xn omega would converge to x omega if and only if omega raised to n goes to 0, right? So this would be same as this, as n goes to infinity, if and only if this vanishes, that is omega raised to n goes to 0. So this happens if and only if omega is less than or greater than or equal to 0 and strictly less than 1. Okay, if omega is equal to 1, then omega raised to n will go to 1. Okay, hence what do I have? I have xn omega converging to x omega for every omega in closed 0 to open 1. Okay. And xn omega does not converge to x omega when omega is equal to 1. Okay. So I can say my n is singleton 1 and n complement is 0, 1. And probability of n complement is of course 1 minus 0 equal to 1. okay, because probability of singleton n is 0. In this scenario, we will say xn converges to x pointwise, does not converge to x. We will say xn does not converge to x pointwise, however, xn converges to x almost surely, because the set of all omegas for which it doesn't converge, this set has probability 0. Okay, or it's a penal set. Penal set means it is a set which has probability 0. Okay, so here we have almost sure convergence but no pointwise convergence. This is how almost sure convergence is different from pointwise convergence. But as you might have realized, even almost sure, demanding almost sure convergence is a very strong requirement, because you want convergence for almost all omegas except for those few whose probability is 0. Hence, to simplify things further, people came up with the concept of convergence in probability. So, what is meant by convergence in probability? Xn be a sequence of random variables. We say that xn converges to x in probability, this is the notation, if probability of mod of xn minus x less than epsilon goes to 1 as n goes to infinity, or probability of mod of xn minus x being greater than epsilon goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. What do I mean by this? It means that set of all omegas for which mod of xn minus x, means difference between xn and x, is less than epsilon, such set should go on becoming bigger and bigger as n goes to infinity. Okay. So, for most and most of omega, the difference between xn and x should become less than epsilon as n goes to infinity. Okay. Let me try to draw a picture. So, suppose this is my capital omega. Okay. So, first I would try fix some epsilon. So, say, and this should happen for every epsilon, right? This should happen for every epsilon. So, given any epsilon, this should happen. So, let me fix epsilon equal to 0.2. Now, let me list all those omegas for which x1 omega minus x omega in absolute is less than 0.2. So, suppose this is collection of those omegas for which x1 omega minus x omega in modulus is less than 0.2. Okay. Now, I go to x2 omega. So, this set should kind of go bigger and bigger as n increases, and it should cover almost entire omega except for those few points for whom probability is 0. Okay. Let me see the same example, the e raised to omega plus omega raised to n. What happens there? So, we have defined xn of omega as e raised to omega plus omega raised to n, and x of omega as omega, sorry, e raised to omega. Okay, so mod of xn omega minus x omega is omega raised to n, correct? Now, we know that omega raised to n goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. As a result, given epsilon greater than 0, there exists n naught which depends on epsilon and omega, such that probability of mod xn omega minus x omega being less than epsilon, which is same as saying probability of omega raised to n being less than epsilon. Omega raised to n being less than epsilon means probability of omega being less than epsilon raised to 1 by n Okay. Now what happens to this probability? This probability would be probability of the interval 0 to epsilon raised to n by n. Okay. Now if epsilon is greater than 1, then this probability is already 1. So I don't need to worry about it. However, if epsilon is less than or equal to 1, then this is 0. Epsilon raised to 1 is here. Epsilon raised to half is bigger, right? Epsilon raised to half is bigger than epsilon, so it is somewhere here. Epsilon raised to 1 by 3 is further bigger. Epsilon raised to 1 by 4 is further bigger. And as n goes to infinity, this goes to 1. Correct? Nth root of epsilon goes to 1 as n goes to infinity. So the interval for which xn omega minus x omega is less than epsilon, that interval goes on becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. Hence, probability convergence is there. Okay. So, probability convergence checks the difference between xn and x. So, the number of omegas for which this difference is less than epsilon, that should go on increasing as n goes to infinity. And finally, it should reach almost entire capital omega. Okay. This is known as probability convergence. In this point-wise and as well as absolute convergence, we saw that there is n naught which depends on both epsilon and omega. Correct? Let me go to the definition. See here. N naught depends on epsilon omega. And even in almost sure convergence, we say that there should exist some n naught which depends on epsilon and omega. Okay. So, if this n naught does not depend on omega, then we say that the convergences are uniform. Okay, so uniform point wise, uniform almost sure. However, in probability convergence, there is no such concept because I am having common n naught for all omegas. We are taking collection of all those omegas for which something happens. So, I am not worrying about each omega separately. That is how probability convergence is different from point wise and almost sure. In point wise and almost sure, we were worrying about every omega, and for every omega we were checking whether the convergence happens or not. Here what we are checking is, for every omega we are computing the difference. However, we are talking about probability of all omegas for which the difference is less than certain thing. And if probability of such a set goes to 1, then we say that the convergence is in probability. Okay. Then the next type of convergence is known as convergence in law or convergence in distribution. What do we mean by this? So, if a sequence of random variables and let fnx be CDF of xn. So fnx be probability of xn less than or equal to x. Okay. So if this converges to probability of x less than or equal to x, which is nothing but CDF of x, for every x in set of continuity points of fx, then we say that xn converges to x in distribution or in law. Okay, so CDF of xn should converge to CDF of x as n goes to infinity. How is it possible? Let us try to check. Let me define some sequence. Suppose xn of omega is a random variable which has uniform distribution on 0 to 1 by n. What is CDF of this xn at some x? It is 0 if x is less than 0. It is 1 if x is greater than 1 by n, because its support is only between 0 to 1 by n. and what happens in between. We know for any uniform AB random variable, CDF at x is x minus a upon b minus a, if x is between AB. So by that logic here, it would be x upon 1 by n minus 0. So 1 by n minus 0 means 1 by n. So I can write it as nx. Okay. So I can simply write it as n times x if x is between 0 and 1 by n. Okay. Now, what happens to this as n goes to infinity? Let me take limit. So if I take limit, then the limit is 0 if x is less than 0. Nx, what happens to this nx? As n goes to infinity, and because x is less than 1, nx actually goes to 1 if x is greater than or equal to 0. Because you know this 1 by n is going to 0. So basically only at 0 I am going to have some weight. Okay, everywhere else, because this 1 by n is shrinking, right? So this is 0, this is 1. 1 by n is shrinking towards 0. So the entire weight is going towards 0. Okay, so this becomes CDF of x. And we know this is CDF of a degenerate random variable at 0. Okay, so we will say that if xn is a sequence of random variables, let's say independent random variables, which have say uniform 0, 1 by n as distribution, then xn omega converges to x omega where x is degenerate at 0. Of course, this is convergence in law. Okay. Is it okay? And one small point here, we are saying that the convergence should happen only at continuity points of fx. Okay. At discontinuity points, you may not have convergence, but that is okay. Now you might feel why this is allowed. Now this is allowed because we have already seen while studying distribution functions that set of continuity points is dense. So if you know a distribution function at set of continuity points, it can be uniquely extended to entire R. Okay. So knowing this is enough. So knowing the convergence at set of continuity points is enough. At discontinuity points, there can be some problems, but it's okay. It doesn't affect our final conclusion. Okay. So this is convergence in law, also known as convergence in distribution. And now let us try to talk about one more type of convergence, which is known as convergence in Rth mean. And if R is equal to 2, we call it quadratic mean. So again, we have a sequence of random variables xn. And we will assume that xn's are integrable up to order r, means expectation of mod xn raised to r exists. And expectation of mod x raised to r also exists and is finite. Okay, then we say that xn converges to x in rth mean if expectation of mod xn minus x raised to r goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. Okay, this is our definition of convergence in rth mean. Expectation of mod xn minus x raised to r should go to 0 as n goes to infinity, and of course for r greater than or equal to 1. We are not talking about fractional kind of things. Okay. If r is equal to 2, we are going to call it quadratic mean convergence. Otherwise, we call it convergence in rth mean or LR convergence. Okay. So quadratic mean would be L2 convergence. Okay, we are going to study properties of some of these convergences in detail, but we need to see some relationships. So point-wise convergence, as we saw, is like the most dominant type of convergence, because it guarantees you convergence for every omega. Pointwise convergence implies almost sure convergence. So almost sure convergence is slightly weak. So you can throw away a small subset and small subset which has priority 0, and you can have convergence on remaining part. Okay. So if you have pointwise convergence, of course you have almost sure convergence also, because you have something extra. Further, almost sure convergence implies convergence in probability. This is important relation, you should know. We won't go into the proof, but this is very important. Almost sure convergence is stronger. So if you have almost sure convergence, then convergence in probability automatically happens. Further, convergence in probability guarantees convergence in distribution. Okay, so convergence in distribution is weaker than convergence in probability. So there are some sequences for which convergence in distribution is there, but convergence in probability is not there. However, reverse way is always true, means convergence in probability always guarantees convergence in distribution. And rth mean convergence is somewhere separate. So it can guarantee convergence in probability. It cannot guarantee almost sure convergence. So I don't have any relationship between almost sure and rth mean as of now. However, almost sure guarantees convergence in probability. Rth mean also guarantees convergence in probability, and convergence in probability guarantees convergence in distribution. Okay. So these are the relationships between different types of convergences. I'm not going from pointwise to rth mean because we don't know whether the expectations exist or not. Okay. So these are the interactions or relationships between different types of convergences. We should always remember that because they are very helpful. So let me stop here. Thank you.